श्री गणेश स्तोत्र। श्री गणेशाय नमः। नारद उवाच, प्रणमे शिरसा देव गौरी पुत्र विनायकम्। भक्तवासम स्मरे नित्यम आयुकमार्थ सिद्धे। प्रथम वक्रतुंड च एक दंत द्वितीयकम्। तृतीय कृष्ण पिंडाक्ष गज वक्त चतुर्थकम्। लंबोदर पंचमं च षष्ठ विकटमेव च। सप्तम विघ्नराजेन्द्र धूम्रवर्णम तथा अष्टमम्। नवम बालचंद्रम च दशम तु विनायकम्। एकादशम गणपति द्वादशम तु गजाननम्। द्वादशैतानि नामानि त्रिसंदेह पठित्र न च विघ्नाभ्यं तस्य सर्वसिद्धिकार प्रभु। विद्यार्थी लभते विद्याधनार्थी लभते धनं पुत्रार्थी लभते पुत्रनमोक्षार्थी लभते गतिम्। जपेन्द्रणपति स्रोत क्षणभिमासे फल लभेत सवत्सरेण सिद्धि च लभते नात्र संशय। अष्टोभ्यो ब्राह्मणे भक्ष्य लिखित्वाया समर्पयेत् तस्य विद्या भवेत् सर्वागणेशस्य प्रसादत। इति श्री नारद पुराणे संकटनाशन गणेश स्तोत्रम संपूर्णम्। Venerated Dio dignitaries, respected Executive Secretary, Director Sir, Registrar Sir, HODs of different departments, Convener Icon 2021, learned delegates from corporate, media and academia, esteemed colleagues and dear students, Namaskar. In the words of Mark Twain, India is the cradle of the human race, the birthplace of human speech, the mother of history, the grandmother of the legend, and the great-grandmother of tradition. Our most valuable and most artistic materials in the history of men are treasured up in India only. To mark an event, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of SMS Fraternity Varanasi, I, Aviral Mishra, welcome you all to this online plenary session of 9th International Conference on Ancient Indian Wisdom, Panacea for Sustainable Well-being. This session has been organized to bring together practitioners and experts to explore diverse thinking and inquiry into the field of wisdom associated with ancient India. We are truly blessed to have amongst us two mavens from Books of Wisdom, Professor Kishore Patwardhan and Professor Lakshmidhar Behra. Great men show politeness in a particular way. A smile suffices to assure you that you are welcome and kept about their avocations as if you were a member of a family. We welcome you, sir. India, the land of Vedas, the remarkable works contain not only religious ideas for a perfect life, but also facts which science has proved true. Electricity, radium, electronics, airships, all were known to the seers who founded the Vedas. These are the words of Ella Wheeler Wilcox. Further to talk upon this, we have with us our first guest, Professor Kishore Patwardhan. Professor Kishore Patwardhan currently works for the Department of Kriya Sharir, Faculty of Ayurveda, Banaras Hindu University. His doctoral work was on identifying various issues, concerns, and challenges of Ayurveda education in India, which he executed through a nationwide survey that involved Ayurveda students and teachers. He is involved in developing and evaluating different teaching learning methods for Kriya Sharir. He has lectured in India and abroad on various topics such as Ayurveda physiology, academic writing, research methods, educational research, and education policy. He has received Ayush sponsored Vaidya Scientist Fellowship from TTU Bengaluru. His research interests include Ayurveda biology, Ayurveda education and policies on higher education. He is a recipient of Dr. C. Dwarika Nath Award of Indian Association for the Study of Traditional Ancient Medicine for the year 2019. He is an editorial board member of the Journal of Ayurveda and Integrative Medicine. He has worked as a member of scientific advisory committees of IPGT and RA Jamnagar, CCRAS and School of Life Sciences, MAHE. He is the coordinator and principal investigator of Ayurveda Network, a component under subject-based network of PMMNMTT scheme of Ministry of Education, Government of India. Now, without wasting much of a time, I request Professor Kishore Patwardhan to kindly decorate this session with his beautiful words. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for giving me this opportunity to be participating in this very interesting and important event. Well, I would like to share my presentation so that So is my presentation visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay, so well, so today I have given the title to my talk as an introduction to Ayurveda, because most of the listeners or viewers may not be acquainted with what Ayurveda is. So I thought of introducing the basics of Ayurveda, and we will be beginning with the history of Ayurveda, and then we will proceed towards the current context. In the current context, what's the relevance of Ayurveda and how we can incorporate Ayurveda in our daily routine lifestyle. So I structured my entire lecture. In the next 30 minutes or so, we will be having a glimpse of Ayurveda in an overview format. It will be a format of overview kind, right? I won't be going into the details, but yes, I would like to emphasize over here that whenever you request for some additional information, I'll be happy to share the links to different resources that are available over internet. So that would be one of the things that I would be doing, right? So as in when you have got some questions, you may interrupt me, you are free to interrupt me, right? So yeah, this is the question with which I would like to start my session, right? So have you ever used Ayurveda? So when I ask this question to laymen, many of them would say that yes, we have used, and many of them would also say that no, so far we have not used Ayurveda. So to those who have not used Ayurveda, who think they have not yet used Ayurveda, I would like to demystify their belief, right? So if you are an Indian and you have been staying in India for quite a few years, then automatically, without your knowledge, right, knowingly or unknowingly, you are using Ayurveda in one or the other form. So let us see what Ayurveda is, right? So whenever I utter the term Ayurveda, so what comes to your mind? So some of them would think of this Ayurvedic massage or Panchakarma, which is which has become a fad these days, right? Some of them would think that, so those are the pills which are marketed in the pharmacies and medical stores, right? Which are with the tag of Ayurveda. Some of them would also think of this Chyawanprash, which is very famous thing, right, in field of Ayurveda. And how many of you would think of your daily spices that you use in your kitchen? That is also Ayurveda. If you are using black pepper, you are using elaichi, you are using methi, you are using haldi, then you are using Ayurveda. So that is how I would like to deconstruct the mystified image of Ayurveda. I would like to say that this entire Ayurveda is there in each and every kitchen of our Indian households. So every one of us, each one of us have been using Ayurveda, right, since our childhood, definitely. So that is how I would like to introduce Ayurveda to you, right? So we have been using Ayurveda. It is interwoven with the cultural and societal fabric of India, right? So that is what Ayurveda is, right? If you are using these things in your daily routine, right, you are using Ayurveda. Now, coming to the brief history of what Ayurveda is. So most of the historians believe that the roots of Ayurveda go back to the Vedic era, right? Especially the Atharvaveda contains certain important references to diseases and certain medicines in the form of medicinal plants. But approximately, it was around 400 BC, right? Around 2500 years ago. So it was the period during which a systematic medical theory started getting documented. So possibly it was there In the form of oral traditions, just like Vedas, Ayurveda was also being taught from generation to generation in the form of oral tradition, right? But it started to be documented in the form of written language, right? That happened somewhere around 400 BC. And the knowledge base of Ayurveda is documented in the form of compendia, and they are known as Samhita, right? Samhitas are the compilations of entire stream of Ayurveda, right? Knowledge or information related to Ayurveda. Now, there are three major textbooks for Ayurveda, and there are three smaller textbooks. We call them big books and small books, right? Big books are Brihat Trayi. Trayi means three, right? So, big trio. So, big, the major, that is actually the major textbooks of Ayurveda. So, one of them is Charaka Samhita. So, Charaka Samhita was originally written by Agnivesha, right? It was around, again, 400 or maybe 300 BC or so. But Charaka, who redacted it in 200 BC, right? His name got stuck with this textbook, though originally it is actually Agnivesha Tantra. Agnivesha was the student of Punarvasu Atreya, and he just took down the notes, lecture notes. Actually, Charaka Samhita is nothing but a lecture note, compilation of lecture notes, right? But it was then redacted and re-edited by Charaka in 200 BC, and then again Dridhabala in 4th century CE AD. So in 4th century AD, this got the completion, right? So the tradition of Ayurveda, the documented tradition of Ayurveda, is unique to Ayurveda. It is not like other ancient medical systems or healthcare systems, right? Which got stagnated and which were never upgraded. But Ayurveda, the uniqueness of Ayurveda is that it has been kept updated as per the time and need. So different scholars, different authors, they kept on contributing, editing, adding the sections, removing the outdated information, and so on. So it has been a progressive science. This is something many of us don't know. Ayurveda has been a progressive science, and many of the commentators who added commentaries to these textbooks, they have been challenging the documented information in the authentic textbook. So Ayurveda basically doesn't believe in authority. It has believed in questioning. This is something very important. And so this happens to be the version that is available even today, right? And it deals primarily with the internal medicine, right? And it also deals with philosophy of Ayurveda, therapeutic principles, Panchakarma, diagnostics, medical interventions, and so on. It is a very, very authentic textbook, even today, regarded as one of the most authentic textbooks. One of the copies of manuscripts of Charaka Samhita is available in our university at Bharat Kala Bhavan. This is the photograph of that manuscript. Then comes Sushruta Samhita. Again, Varanasi has been a place where Ayurveda has been nurtured by different scholars, right? So Sushruta lived in Varanasi. Many of us, we might not be knowing this, but Sushruta Samhita, or Sushruta, the author of Sushruta Samhita, he lived in Banaras and he practiced surgery. So he happens to be the father of plastic surgery. He is recognized to be the father of plastic surgery, but his contributions to other surgical branches are also equally important. So this is the photograph of, painting of Sushruta Samhita, which is present in BHU. And this is a replica of the instrument, surgical instrument that was used by Sushruta. But this replica is present in Malcolm Library in London, right? So again, this was around, again, 400 BC or so. It was authored by Sushruta. And original textbook was redacted by, again, Nagarjuna. Again, this edition and reincorporation of newer things is a tradition of Ayurveda. So in 5th century AD, so Nagarjuna re-edited it or edited it. And then further, it was amended by Chandrata in 10th century CE. So the current textbook that is available with us in the name of Sushruta Samhita is actually the edited version by Chandrata, right? So certain very interesting topics have been discussed in Sushruta Samhita. He has elaboratively discussed the training method prescribed for acquiring surgical skills while performing various surgical procedures such as suturing, excision, incision, puncturing, probing, and others, using different models which is a unique contribution, right? He has used or advised to use several vegetables, certain fruits, or certain wood, and so on. So it is, I mean, very, very pertinent even today, right? And different procedures of bandaging, wound treatment, fracture management have also been documented in this Samhita. And it contains a detailed description of surgical instruments, there's classification, anatomical description of human body, and so on. Even the dead body dissection of the dead human bodies has been documented in Sutra Samhita. So again, these are the sets of replicated or replica of instruments that have been described in Sutra Samhita. They have been kept in a Wellcome Library, London, right? See, this practice of plastic surgery was continuing in Ayurvedic tradition in India, and certain vaidyas, right? Traditional vaidyas, they used to practice this surgery. And one of such case reports where the nose was reconstructed was published as early as in 1794, in 18th century, early 18th century, right? It was published in Gentleman's Magazine, and that is how Western world came to know about the techniques of this plastic surgery, right? So Sushruta's technique of plastic surgery was being practiced by certain traditional vaidyas, and this was documented by certain people, right? And it was published in Western media, right? This is the actual photograph of that magazine, right? Which was published in 1794. So that is how Sushruta is regarded as the father of plastic surgery. Well, then comes Ashtanga Hridaya, which was a later text comparatively written in 6th century AD, and author is Vanpheta. So it is a compilation of both Charaka and Sushruta, and very popular in the southern states, especially in Kerala. This is the very commonly practiced or used textbooks, because it is regarded as a textbook that has the most practical and application oriented content. Then comes Laghutrayi, the three smaller books, right? Minor books, but they are not minor actually in their content. So Bhava Prakasha explains the materia medica, medicinal plants, the useful parts of the medicinal plants, morphology, pharmacological actions, indications, and so on. Whereas Madhava Nidana is a textbook which contains clinical diagnosis, pathological principles, and so on. Whereas Shyamakantara Samhita is related to pharmacy, right? Pharmaceutical sciences, different formulations, their dosage forms, right? The method of preparation, shelf life, all this has been explained in Shyamakantara Samhita. Even the measurements, how much of measure of a particular ingredient has to be there in a particular, maybe churna, maybe avaleha, maybe vati, right? Vati is pill, right? Avaleha is chavanaprash, for example, the lickable formulation, semi-solid formulation. Then there are churnas, right? Powdered herbs. Then swarasa, the juice, fresh juice. And then there are kwathas or kashayas, decoctions, right? So different dosage forms have been documented in Shyamakantara Samhita. Now coming to the basic concepts of Ayurveda, how Ayurveda is basically different from the current or contemporary medical sciences, and what are the additional benefits that one can achieve by understanding what is Ayurveda, right? So Ayurveda is a science that focuses on holistic principles, right? So what is holistic principles? This is the sentence from Charaka Samhita, of course, translated one. So one cannot have the knowledge of the whole simply by knowing the parts. This is the fundamental principle of holism as explained in Charaka Samhita, right? You cannot have the knowledge of the whole, especially, for example, whole body. You cannot understand the entire body by understanding a simple cell or its organelle, right? So this is something very, very interesting, and the classical thinking in modern sciences or mainstream sciences, natural sciences, it has always been reductionistic in approach, right? It was always thought that if you understand the functioning of a cell, you will be able to extrapolate it into the entire living organism, right? So it believes that complex systems can be understood by seeking out their most fundamental constituents. In case of biology, it may be cells and subcellular organisms, subcellular organelle, right? The complex problems are resolved by dividing them into smaller, simpler, and more tractable units. This is called divide and conquer principle, right? The modern science, it uses this divide and conquer principle, right? Even today, it goes into the molecular biology, right? Molecular level of understanding. And then they extrapolate these interactions to the whole. But this, though it has been very helpful, right, in advancement of the science, but at the same time, it has got several limitations as well, right? For example, Francis Crick, who identified or described the structure of DNA, he once upon a time, he wrote in a book that the ultimate aim of the modern movement in biology is, in fact, to explain all biology in terms of physics and chemistry. That is how he wanted to reduce biology into physics and chemistry. But actually, life is not that simple. Living beings are very, very complex beings. Life is a complex phenomenon, right? So the complex biological activity is not due to specific individual molecules, right? And to understand the nature of the life, an organism cannot be treated like machine, right? Often you see this simile or analogy of computers being given to understand the human life, right? Input devices, for example, sensory organs, then output devices, maybe the motor organs, then processing, maybe in the central nervous system. So these are the analogies that are often drawn, but computer doesn't have the ability to self-destruct and self-repair itself, but our body has, right? Every day, billions of cells, they die, and equal number of new cells are generated. This is the uniqueness of biological sciences, right? And this, hence, this is a very difficult to understand. This is a complex phenomenon. It cannot be compared with a machine, right? So now comes the importance of holistic principles. So classical medicine is based on this reductionistic theory, right? As I told you, that this divide and conquer, right? But such a view misses out the most important thing, that is, the body is a whole, right? By missing out the interactions between different cells, different organs, different systems, right? You miss out on the entire understanding of the human body, right? So for example, the state of your mind affects the state of your gut, which may in turn affect the state of your mind. For example, anxiety. If you're anxious, you tend to get diarrhea. And this further enhances, it may further enhance your anxiety. See, this is how mind and body are interconnected, right? So Ayurveda treats the state that leads to a disease to be more important than mere this cause and that disease. Okay, so this is where Ayurveda differs. Ayurveda gives more importance to the state that leads to a disease. The individual, why did he develop this disease? Right? It's not what was the cause of this disease and how to treat that cause. So this, it is not a linear cause and effect relationship. It is a complex multifactorial relationship, right? So now the even modern science is understanding its limitations. And now a new branch called systems biology is developing. And this is from one of the very popular websites, right? Where it is written that what is systems biology? Systems biology is based on the understanding that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Got it? This is nothing but, it is the exact sentence that has been documented in Charaka Samhita. And the modern science is realizing this only now. This systems biology is only some maybe around 20 years old branch that is developing. So that is how Ayurveda has understood very, very important secrets of the living beings. So it uses a theory called Tri Dosha theory. Many of you might have heard Vata, Pitta and Kapha, right? So some of the scholars, they simply say that, no, this is unscientific, ancient theory, and there are humors, right? Three humors. No, it is not humoral theory. It is wrong to translate Vata, Pitta as humors, right? It is a fundamental principle, theoretical principle that is used to explain the bodily functions, the Pharmacological interventions, therapeutics, maybe even diagnostics, everywhere, even in nutrition, even in pharmacology, we use Vata, Pitta and Kapha principles, right? So these are the fundamental functions of Vata, Pitta and Kapha. So Vata is initiator, motive force, controller, divider, sensor, and is responsible for movements. Pitta is responsible for heat production, energy, digestion, metabolism. And Kapha is responsible for strength, resistance, protection, structural integrity, immunity, and growth. See, these are the three different domains, and there is almost negligible amount of overlap, right? And now again, a new science is emerging. This is called neuroimmunoendocrinology. And if you consider Vata functions, right, they are very, very close to nervous system functions. The Pitta functions are very close to the endocrine system, right? And Kapha functions are very closely associated to immune functions. So neuroimmunoendocrinology is nothing but an extension of this Tridosha theory, which is emerging now, right? So now Ayurveda classifies the entire population based on, again, Vata, Pitta and Kapha, right? So of course there could be a mixture of Vata, Pitta, Pitta, Kapha and so on, right? So this is known as Prakriti. So each individual can be identified and classified under specific Prakriti based on certain anatomical, physical and physiological characteristics, right? For example, you can understand whether you fall under Vata Prakriti, Pitta Prakriti or Kapha Prakriti. Okay, so these are certain basic explanations, right? How can you identify your own Prakriti? For example, Vata Prakriti individual, usually they have lean and thin body frame, unstable with respect to hunger, bowel movements, sleep, determination and so on. So they are always unstable, right? Sometimes the hunger is good, sometimes the hunger is weak. Sometimes the bowel movements are normal, sometimes they are irregular. Sometimes they sleep well, sometimes they do not sleep well. So this is a typical feature of Vata Prakriti. Similarly, quickness is the function of or feature of Vata. So they are very quick to get started, very quick to grasp. Similarly, very quick to forget and also very quick to catch diseases. So that is how Vata Prakriti individuals, right? They are defined, right? They have got this cold intolerance in for example, in winters, they feel miserable, right? Their skin and hair are dry. They are unstable. They have got some this unstable bonding with people. So bonding is relationship problems are very common with Vata individuals. Whereas Pitta is related with the energy, heat and digestion metabolism. So they have got very strong hunger, good digestion, good analytical skills, good leadership qualities. And early, baldness and graying is another feature. Or easy irritability, short temperedness, numerous moles and freckles and pigmented patches on the body might be present, intense body odor and heat intolerance. So they feel miserable in summers, not in winters, right? Similarly, Kapha Prakriti individuals, right? They have got their own features. They have got a strong muscular body, attractive physique and voice, thick, shiny hair, but they are slow. Slow to start, slow to eat, slow to work out, slow to catch a disease, slow to grasp, but slow to forget also. Once they have grasped it, then they won't forget it. They have got again this cold intolerance, right? No irritability, calm and composed, and usually strong bonding and relationships, right? They are very good they are very good at maintaining strong relationships. So by using these questions or these features, right, you can identify to which Prakriti you belong to. And based on your Prakriti, there are different dietary advices which Ayurveda gives, lifestyle advices which Ayurveda gives, right, based on Prakriti, right? If you belong to Vata Prakriti, for example, right, so you should not indulge in more and more cold stuff, right, and so on. There are so many things, right? So this is one of the questionnaires that we have developed, which is available for download. So by giving this course, particular course, you can identify to which Prakriti you belong to. And this is a validated questionnaire, right? So yeah, those who are interested, they can just download, go to this link and they can download and they can assess their own prakriti, right? So that they can understand to what prakriti they belong and they can follow certain dietary guidelines and lifestyle guidelines, right? For example, Kapha Prakriti people, they tend to be sedentary, they tend to be lazy people. So they need to more physically active. Whereas Vata Prakriti people are very, very active. So they need a certain level of calmness and composed or resting is required for Vata Prakriti individuals. So this is how the different lifestyle advices are given in Ayurveda, right? So this, again, Prakriti is now being evaluated for its association with particular genetics, right? Genetic composition of individuals. So genome-wide analysis correlates Ayurveda Prakriti. This was a paper which was published in very reputed journal, highly reputed journal, Scientific Reports, Nature journal, right? So now even the Prakriti and genetic association has been almost established. So that is the power of Ayurveda, right? So, now what is the relevance of Ayurveda in today's life? Right? So one is Prakriti, as I told you, if you know what is Prakriti and how to use it, then it is useful. So the human genome has not changed much during the last 10,000 years. Remember, for last 10,000 years, our genetic makeup has remained the same. Whereas the diet and lifestyle of human race has witnessed a huge shift during the same period, right? We don't live the lifestyle of 10,000 years old human beings, right? Hence, there is a mismatch between our lifestyle and genetic makeup, which is of serious consequences. So what does Ayurveda teach us? For example, Charaka Samhita contains many chapters that are exclusively devoted to dietetics, daily routine and seasonal routine. Excessive nutrition leading to diseases such as obesity have been elaborately discussed in the textbook, right? Even the effects of excessive intake of salt, requirement of regular physical exercise, advocacy for restricted and timely food intake, all this has been explained in Charaka Samhita. Emphasis on locally available, naturally grown food grains. This is something very important and maybe impractical to follow in the current times, but this is what has been mentioned in Ayurveda, right? Vegetables and fruits which are naturally grown and locally grown, right? Locally available, right? Then the ill effects of living in crowded townships and those of a sedentary lifestyle too have been documented in Charaka Samhita. See how futuristic this textbook is, right? Even the sedentary lifestyle and crowded townships has been explained in Charaka Samhita, right? Even the pandemics have been documented in Charaka Samhita. It is called, there is a separate chapter for pandemics, right? Janapadodhvamsa, where the entire communities are lost, right? So this is how Ayurveda is relevant even in today's context. So there is something called person-centric approach in Ayurveda, because we, if 10 patients suffering from same disease come to an Ayurvedic doctor, he might prescribe 10 different drugs to 10 different people. Whereas in modern science, it is not so, right? If there is fever, almost all of you are going to get paracetamol. But in Ayurveda, it is not so, right? Even though you are suffering from same disease, maybe rheumatoid arthritis, 10 patients, but each of them would possibly receive 10 different prescriptions, because this is how Ayurveda individualizes the treatment. Okay, this is called individualized approach or person-centric medicine. And this is again new trend in modern medicine, right? Personalized medicine or person-centric approach is emerging trend in modern medicine, right? But Ayurveda has always been person-centric. So this is very, very important, right? So Ayurveda considers several aspects of an individual, such as individual constitution, maybe digestive strength, seasonality, mental strength, individual immunity, etc., while understanding the health and disease. And this can help us tackle some of these challenges, right? So dietary prescriptions according to one's prakriti can be of immense value. Then the effects of routine administration of panchakarma, right? Maybe vamana, emesis, therapeutic purgation, therapeutic enema, and so on, right? So these purificatory measures, right? among healthy individuals has been advised in Ayurveda. So this merits serious evaluation, and keeping in mind view the emerging role of gut microbiota in maintaining health. So these are certain points that make Ayurveda still relevant, and I think I have kept myself within the allotted time limit. So I conclude my talk here, and I would be glad to have any questions or any other queries from your side. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Yeah, PPT.
Yes.
I'll send you. No issues. I'll send you the PPT. Yeah.
Okay. So one of the greatest American writers of the 20th century, F. Scott Fitzgerald, once said, "The test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposing ideas in the mind at the same time and still retain the ability to function." The first speaker of this session is a living example of such intelligence. Thank you, sir, for sharing such valuable insights with us.
Thank you. You are most welcome. I have just shared a link to 1 minute. Everyone, yeah. So this is a network of Ayurveda experts that we have established in BHU, and this is the website where you will be able to access more than 350 video lectures given by very highly recognized experts from all over the country, right? And even some of them are from abroad. So maybe those who are interested, they can go through this website that we have developed. And with this, I think, I once again convey my thanks to the organizers for having given me this opportunity. Thank you.
Any other question from any other participants? You're most welcome.
Thank you, sir. Kamalashil Mishra. Rajeshri, thank you.
Sir, may I ask one question?
Definitely.
Sir, what will be the right food for Vata category persons?
Yeah, Vata Prakriti individuals, usually they are towards lower body mass index. They are usually very thin and lean, right? So they need more nourishing food like proteins. They need more proteins. They need more carbohydrates, even to some extent fats. But for example, Kapha-Prakriti individuals, fatty diet should be restricted. It is not good for them. They are likely to get more and more kind of diabetes, coronary artery disease, and so on. So they are more common in Kapha and Pitta-Prakriti individuals. But in Vata-Prakriti individuals, they are susceptible to some other diseases like neurological disorders, right? So in Vata-Prakriti individuals, intake of fats is advocated. See, this is how Ayurveda differs from modern medicine, right? Modern science, it asks you to restrict everything, right? Maybe fat is bad, carbohydrate is bad. But if you go to an Ayurvedic Vaidya, right? He would say that no, to a Vata-Prakriti person, yes, certain amount of fats is allowed. So this is what Ayurveda is.
So if people change their Prakriti also as per passage of time?
No. Prakriti doesn't change. It remains the same. Yeah. But yes, by adapting to the appropriate lifestyle, they can become stable and they can improvise themselves. Yeah.
So there are two more questions in the chat box.
Yes.
Yeah. So there is a question from Pramod Suvarna. Can there be a Prakriti which is a combination of Vata, Pitta and Kapha, all three?
Yes. See, there are actually seven types of people, right? Vata, Pitta, Kapha, three. Then Vata, Pitta, Pitta, Kapha, Vata, Kapha, right? So again, two combinations of two. So 3+3, 6. And then one category, which is very rare, equal balance of Vata, Pitta and Kapha. This is called Samadoshacha Prakriti. But getting such individuals is very, very rare. Very rare. But Yeah, they cannot be ruled out. Yeah, if a person is very healthy and living a healthy lifestyle, possibly he is of, because of his prakriti, possibly he is of, or she is of samadoshi prakriti.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Dr. Patavardhan. Hello, Dr. Patavardhan.
Yes.
I have a question. How, do I have to go to an Ayurvedic doctor to know what is my prakriti, or I can know myself?
I'll share with you one of our papers where we have developed a tool where you can assess yourself what is your prakriti, right? So this is a self assessment tool, right? You can print, get the printout of that tool, and then you can assign the specific scores that have been indicated against each question. There are some questions, right? And there are some specific scores. And if the answer is yes, then you have to allot that much of scores. So it is developed after research, right? We have applied a mathematical model. So with this link, if you go to this link, there is a paper. You can download the paper, and also you can download the tool under supplementary material. There is something called supplementary material. You can download it and you can get a printout and you can assess your own prakriti by yourselves. But of course, it is always advisable that you consult an Ayurvedic physician to have a confirmatory evaluation, because this is a preliminary questionnaire, right? It is intended at to be useful at screening level, but you have to have a confirmatory test by consulting a physician. That is what I would advise.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Rajshri Gokhale. Mm-hmm. The question is prakriti genetic?
Yes. Actually, there are two components to prakriti, right? Genetics and epigenetics both play an important role, right? So genetic is, definitely it is genetic. That is how I showed you a paper where it has been shown that yes, genetic association has been established with prakriti. But while determination of prakriti, there is some epigenetic factors also. Epigenetics is related with environment, right? So genetic factors and environmental factors, both of them, they decide what your prakriti is. And there have been certain studies where in management schools, they have assessed the prakriti and they are doing this work. Who are the most suitable persons to take up which kind of a business and so on and so forth. So this is a very interesting field. Could be, we can collaborate with you guys if you are interested. We will be definitely willing to be helpful. Yeah, collaborate rather. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Vishal Malik. The question is, I observed pitta can cure kapha problem, like start eating pitta, increasing food. Then we can use these pravarti against each other. Is it possible, sir?
Yes. Actually, see, I did not go into the details. So vata, pitta, kapha have got specific attributes, like cold. Cold is an attribute for vata, whereas pitta is hot. So it is not simply, I mean, it doesn't mean that it is cold on touch. It's not the that gross level of understanding, but it is actually at the level of physiology and pharmacology, right? So there are always opposite, equal and opposite features, right? Vata, pitta and kapha. I showed you a figure where three vectors were shown, right? So equal and opposite forces, right? If they're acting equally and in the opposite directions, there will be stability. And this is what is the state of health, right? So obviously, the opposite things will cure or help in mitigating the problems caused due to some other just opposite properties. So, but vata and pitta are not absolutely opposite. They're somewhat opposite, and there is some overlapping also. But yes, your observation is absolutely appreciated. Yes, it is true.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
The next question is from P.K. Patra. And an ever-increasing number of herbal medicines are entering the market with expiry dates. We have heard as children that Ayurvedic medicines don't have any expiry date and are highly stable. Kindly shed some light on this.
No. In Shankadhara Samhita, I mentioned that even shelf life has been explained and documented. For Churna, for example, not more than 6 months is they are stable. They are not stable for more than 6 months. For Asava and Arishta, for example, they are a bit longer. They are stable for a longer duration. Bhasmas, they are high. They have got a very long shelf life. So it depends on, the shelf life depends on the dosage form, which kind of a formulation that you are talking about. For example, fresh juice, right, swarasa, it doesn't last for more than few hours. It has to be consumed while it is fresh. You cannot keep amla juice, right, for more than 2 days or so. So there is shelf life, there is expiry for each and every Ayurvedic medicine. That is something very, very important. Yeah. This is a misconception that is prevalent among the public, that Ayurvedic medicines do not have side effects. They are very safe. No, it may not be safe, right? So because, see, effect, if there is some effect, there will be some side effect also. For example, see, if the gut, right, if you have diarrhea, and if a doctor prescribes something that decreases the motility of the gut, certain drugs which decrease the motility, they have also got the effect on respiratory system. Right? So certain cough syrups, they may induce constipation. So relieving the cough is the effect, but constipation is side effect. But the same drug can be used to treat diarrhea because producing constipation is the effect there. So the term effect and side effects, they are relative terms. So from which angle you are looking at, right? So side effects are possible with Ayurvedic drugs also. And even toxicity is possible if you consume them in higher than recommended doses. You have to be very careful. So you should never consume Ayurvedic drugs without the prescription of an Ayurvedic, qualified Ayurvedic vaidya. This is something very important. Public in the population, they have got this misconception that Ayurveda, are kuch bhi chalega, le lo, kuch nahi hoga. No, it is not so.
Any other questions? I think, sir, all queries are sorted now. So thank you so much, sir. By listening your speech, we can proudly say, yes, we have a gem, medical gem in the form of Ayurveda, a song line to end upon. That is, it happens only in India. So thank you so much, sir, for sharing such valuable insights with us. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I enjoyed a lot. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so let's move ahead. Albert Einstein once said, when I read the Bhagavad Gita and reflect about how God created this universe, everything else seems so superfluous. To talk upon this, we have with